these meetings, these big, high-profile, week-long, let's-talk-about-the-world kind of events, as somebody invests in the early stage, do you see a trickle-down of benefit from something like that?
I think it's good to put the topic on the world stage. The media, like yourself, are picking it up and talking about it, and it really helps the startups who are already working in it to get some momentum and get people talking about certain sectors that perhaps haven't received such media exposure. There's been a lot of focus on carbon and carbon accounting, but what about biodiversity? What about nature? This is being put on the, you know, on the radar now. So I think it's important that we do have these meetings at this global stage.
What's interesting is we just heard from Jeremy Hunt. Meanwhile, his leader, the Prime Minister of the UK, is getting a lot of heat for basically putting climate goals to one side. And I'm interested in your perspective of the politicization of the space in which you work. I mean, certainly that's here in the United States as well. Has there been as much interest in backing funds that want to invest in climate startups?
I mean, I was looking at PitchBook the other day, and it reported that in Q1 2023, climate tech startups raised $5.7 billion, so 279 VC deals, which is a 36% decline in deal value and 31% decline in deal count from the previous quarter. But that's a lag indicator for me, because when I'm out there and I see when we're raising, you know, our fund and I meet people who want to invest in Ananda, I don't see this hesitation. I just see more and more money coming from many different areas coming into climate. So I think the dip in climate investing of that last quarter is just a general reflection of the dip in VC funding overall and not an indicator of where things are going.
So let's talk about how you stand out from the crowd. At one point, it felt like a very busy crowd. But what's interesting about Ananda is you sort of put your money where your mouth is and you don't take fees unless... Well, the companies which you're backing are saying what they're going to do, and you're holding yourself to some sort of transparency account here. Is that something that's being copied by the rest of the industry?
It's increasingly being copied, and we wanted that. It's called our impact carry model. We created it back in 2014 alongside the European Investment Fund, so it's a co-creation where the carry is linked to the impact. So we have impact KPIs, and we need to meet at least 60% of those targets from those predictions from those startups to be able to see any carry at all. So it means you really values align, and the founders really like it, and of course our investors do. I think it's really important that we have something like this around accountability and governance in impact investing to stop impact washing. Which, you know, you've got greenwashing, you've also got impact washing.
Zoe, what is the AI climate play for a venture capitalist like you?
Oh, there's lots of different things. I think the biggest area is in machine learning. That's what we've seen for the last few years. So going from looking at computer vision that's tracking, that's thermal cameras with nanosatellites, being able to detect and look at prevention of wildfire, massive area, and then down to being able to predict in wastewater. Wastewater surveillance is a big new area in climate tech, and pathogens, so being able to start to track different pathogens like the COVID virus, which is viral, but actual bacterial ones, and being able to predict which areas might not respond to antibiotics. So antibiotic resistance is massive. So that's when you start to see the environment cross over into population health and then regenerative ag. What else? Lots of things going on in ocean tech, very difficult area at the moment. And biodiversity, nature, as I was referring to before. A wonderful, wonderful new area, much more tangible to talk about than carbon. And I think there's a lot we can do around being able to track nature using environmental DNA on the ground and being able to predict and what species have been removed, either through infrastructure or mining or something in the water, anything that's being dug up, and replacing that and making it better than it was before, because those little microbes, so it's not that the big species that you think about, big animals, it's actually the microbes in the water. They leave trails of pieces of DNA, and we can detect all of those. And they're the ones that when you talk about our food and our soil systems, they're absolutely essential for the balance that we have in nature, and those are the ones that are suffering.